Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Thank you for coming. My name is Kevin Coots, and I'm pleased to welcome Megan McArdle to the Microsoft Research Visiting Speaker Series. Megan's here to discuss her book, The Upside of Down, Why Failing Well is the Key to Success. She argues that America is unique in its willingness to let people and companies fail, but also in its determination to let them pick up after the fall. Failure is how people and businesses learn. Megan is a Washington, D.C.-based writer and columnist for Bloomberg View, and she has a BA from the University of Pennsylvania and an MBA from the University of Chicago's Graduate School of Business. She's here to tell us how to harness the power of failure, and for those who can't get enough of learning how to harness the power of failure, she'll be at the at another book signing and presentation at the town hall at 8th and Seneca in downtown Seattle at 7:30 p.m. tonight. But please join me now in giving her a very warm welcome.
This is a little nerve-wracking because normally I would come to a company and I would talk about the power of experimentation and iteration, but I feel like doing that at a tech company is like trying to teach my grandmother how to cook. I mean, you guys know this, right? Most products fail, most things aren't a good idea, and the way that you find that out is by trying something, seeing how it works, and then mostly finding out that it doesn't, but sometimes finding out something that does. So instead, I'm going to talk today about why I write and why I don't write. And this is not just a talk for writers, because it's about why we don't dare greatly, why we hold ourselves back from that sort of experimentation. So I'll start off by saying this is really interesting for me because before I went to business school, my colleagues at The Economist nicknamed me Ms. Zeitgeist because I seemed to have participated in every major trend for about from the 90s to about mid-2005. I graduated from college with an English degree, worked for a bunch of startups, all of which went under very quickly. It looks great on my resume. People are really impressed when I say I work for three startups, and I have to be like, no, like 4 months was about the mean time to failure. At one point, a friend of mine who was an equity analyst asked me if I would please let him know if any of the companies he covered made me an offer because he needed to short the stock. And what I did actually between the failed startups and business school was that I was a Microsoft certified systems engineer. I used to go and install, I used to go and install big Microsoft networks for banks. And then I actually installed the first Bloomberg, as far as I know, the first open Bloomberg terminals in publication, and now I work for Bloomberg and I'm speaking at Microsoft. So I feel like I've now come totally full circle. And I'm just gonna spend the rest of this talk telling all of the tech jokes that I haven't been able to tell for the last 15 years. I have one that's great. Its punchline is, my Nick doesn't have a MAC address. It's hilarious. No one gets it. No, I hope there were some engineers in the room who thought it was really funny. So how did I end up here? Well, I went to business school in 2001, having come out of the tech world. In 1999, I tried technology investment banking, whereupon I learned that there was no inner investment banker waiting to get out of me. And having watched the NASDAQ crash from the lobby of my Merrill Lynch training group, decided that what I needed to do was technology management consulting full-time after school. So I got a job doing this. And the great thing about business school is a great place for people who just want to punch all the buttons in the right order and then have everything come out sort of guaranteed, like one of those old punch card computers, right? Like you just punch it in and then everything goes smoothly, or it's supposed to, because you did what you were supposed to. And so I did what I was supposed to. I did on-campus recruiting, and in October I had a job. So, I mean, talk about senioritis, right? Like, basically, the second year of business school is just one long. Actually, I took some great classes, including with Austin Goolsbee, who was for a while the head of the Council of Economic Advisors. But I was set. I didn't have to worry. And so I had a great second year. And then about March or April of my second year, the company called me and said, you know, business is just a little slower than we thought it would be. So how about, you were supposed to start in October, what about February? And I was like, okay, February, I can do February. So I called my mom and I said, Mom, can I come home? And I moved in with my, to my parents' spare bedroom just for a few months. And then 9/11 happened, and I'm from Manhattan, so I was actually living there at the time. And in the supreme irony of my life as a libertarian blogger, my father is a lobbyist. So every time I would make lobbying jokes, he would send me an email like, you do know what paid for college, right? Well, part, among his clients were the heavy construction industry of New York, and one of his clients was down at the site. And through a series of oddly improbable events, I ended up actually working down at the World Trade Center site for a year. And while I was there, I started a blog, and I was originally going to blog. Now, keep in mind, I actually said I wanted to be a writer when I was 8. So now at the age of 30, I'm sitting in a construction trailer living in my parents' spare bedroom. How did that happen? I wrote my first book when I was 8 years old. It was in a composition book. It was a novel. It was not very good. I think it had a hero named Janie. She was on a bus for a while. But I'd always chosen, like many students in business school, I had repeatedly chosen to move away from that because it was not safe. It was very risky, right? It's about the most insane thing that you can do is to decide that you want to be a writer. And so I had gotten skills. I had been in tech for a while. I'd gone to business school. I was going to go back into tech at a higher level. And then the management consulting firm called again and said, so business is a little slower than we were expecting. You were going to start in February. What about May? And I was like, okay, May. And I made arrangements to stay longer at the project working at the World Trade Center site. And I started a blog. But to this point, I had written a bunch of fiction, including the worst novel ever written in the English language. And I'm not talking about the one I wrote when I was 8. Luckily, I had the good sense never to show it to anyone. And then I started this blog. And I was originally going to write about what it was like to be down at the World Trade Center site. And I then quickly realized that that would get me arrested and or fired. So instead, I started putting my business school curriculum up because it was 2001. And blogs were not like something your grandmother does in her retirement. It was actually something new and cool. And there was no one on the internet who was writing about accounting and explaining why WorldCom had failed and so forth. So I started doing this, and I got fairly big traffic. And then the management consulting firm called again and said, so how about never? Does never work for you? And there I was, adrift. It took me another year to find a job. Actually, I found lots of jobs. I got a job doing, pretty senior job doing IT for the city of New York. Then they had a hiring freeze. I passed the foreign service exam. I got through all, and this is like a multi-layered 9-month process. I made through all of it and then flunked the medical. I got a lot of jobs, none of which ever started. And just as I was really at the nadir, I said to my parents, I think I might want to become a journalist because I'm getting, people are asking me to write articles. I love this. I love this more than anything else I've ever done. As you can imagine, my parents were about as thrilled as all parents are when you announce that you're going to use your $100,000 education to embark on freelance journalism, a lucrative and safe career. I think my dad actually said to me, well, how would you think about this as a business school problem? It's like, really, I would project the cash flows, and then I would discount them back, because a dollar today is worth more than a dollar tomorrow. And he said, please do that. So I sat down and I did it, and it had about the same expected value as becoming addicted to crack. But I did it anyway, of course. Which is how more than a few substance abuse problems have started, no doubt. And then, just as I was really at the depths, I interviewed for The Economist. And then once again, nothing happened. 3 months passed before I heard from them. And I went out to this business school event. I'm living in my parents' spare bedroom. I don't really have any money. I mean, I have a little bit of money, but I have $1,000 a month in loan payments. So any discretionary income is kind of already earmarked. And so I'm circulating around this event with a glass of water. And everyone's having babies and getting married, and they have awesome jobs, and I am unemployed and living in my parents' spare bedroom, which is exactly as lame as it sounds. And a guy I didn't know very well walked up to me and said, so how are you? And I said, I am perilously close to despair. How are you? He did what about anyone would do at that point, was he just stared at me for a really long time, and then he kind of sidled away. Like he was afraid to turn his back on me. And then 2 weeks after that, The Economist called and offered me a job. And I actually, when I got on the phone with this guy, he was a very reserved British man named Anthony Gottlieb, He said, you know, well, actually, I'm calling to offer you a job. And I said, I'll take it. And he said, excellent. You know, we were thinking of paying you $40,000 a year. I was like, you're going to pay me? And then I realized I sounded like an idiot. And I was like, that's fine. And, so, and then I called my boyfriend, and I said, I got a job. And I started crying. And that had never happened to me before in my life. I'm not like one of those people who just like, they see a bunny rabbit in the road, and they just start tearing up. I was really only ever cried in happiness one other day in my life, and that was on my wedding day. And my bridesmaid made me stop because my mascara was running. What I realized in retrospect, and the ultimate genesis of this book, was that that process, that miserable, horrible, terrible, horrible, no good, very bad process of feeling really awful, was also the reason that I got to do this amazing thing that I've now been doing for the last 12 years. Because if I had had that management consulting job that paid six figures, could I have taken a job that paid a third as much with my $1,000 a month loan payments in New York, by the way, because that's where the job was? I mean, I was living really lean for a while. You talk about lean manufacturing. I was eating things for dinner like ramen and cheese doodle surprise, where the surprise is that you're 30 years old and still eating ramen and cheese doodles for dinner. I couldn't have dared to do it, right? It really is true that freedom can be another word for nothing left to lose. And one of the great things about writing this book is how many people, so I actually did it, I did a little web survey, and I looked at what happens when you type the words, the best thing that ever happened to me, into Google, and you get some really interesting results. I mean, actually, the main result is that there's this song called The Best Thing That Ever Happened to Me, and that's number one. But if you drill down into the results, you see a lot of things like getting cancer, going to rehab, getting left at the altar, and not really what you would think of as what you expect to think of as your highlight moment, right? But in fact, it's actually true. Being unemployed for 2 years, or functionally unemployed for 2 years, was the best thing that ever happened to me. Because since the age of 8 until the age of 30, I had been fleeing from the thing that I most wanted to do because it wasn't safe. And eventually, at the point where I really had nothing left to lose, I fled back to it, and it turned out that, you know what? Doing something that you love passionately and are really good at is a good career move. Surprisingly enough, a better career move than spending your entire life trying to be safe. So the second part of this talk, I'll talk about, that's why I write. So why do I not write? And this is the dirty secret of writers, is that all writers really love being about to write and having written. We don't like the part in between. And so we avoid it. Why do we do this? And it's funny because it gets worse. You would think it would get better the more experience you get, and in fact, it often gets worse the more experience you get. And for a long time, I labored under the impression that I was the only person who was doing this. The Atlantic gave me basically a column, but because it's The Atlantic and their idea of something short is just 2,500 word reported feature every month, which doesn't sound like a lot, but takes a lot of time and takes even more time rolling around on the floor convinced that you are worthless and are never going to write anything good again. And after months of this, I finally got the courage to walk up to one of my colleagues who is a great writer and writes these amazing 10,000 word profiles of politicians and so forth. And they're funny and they're well reported and they flow. Once you start, it's like Pringles, you just can't stop. And I said to him, how do you do it? How do you do it? Because I'm struggling with this little dinky 2,500 word column every month. How do you do this? And he said, oh, it's easy. First, I procrastinate for 3 weeks, and then I clean my garage. And I get the garage really clean, and then I walk upstairs, and I sit down at my desk, and I stare at the wall for a while. And then I walk back downstairs, and I complain to my wife. Then maybe I go clean the bathroom, and so forth. And it turns out that we all do this. And almost every writer I've ever talked to does this. Even writers who think that they don't procrastinate, then they get the big assignment, the one that they've always wanted to have, and suddenly, like, it's like Siberia. My editor, the editor of this book, told me about the first book that she got to edit when she started, when she moved up from editorial assistant to editor. It had been commissioned in 1972. This was sometime in the early to mid 90s. Books, the bigger the project, the more likely you are to procrastinate. So why? Why do we do this? And I developed a theory over time, which is that we were too good at English class. is that success is actually a problem. When you are trying to do something new and great, your past success is often your biggest handicap. So basically, with some exceptions, most writers who are writing at the professional level, just like most people who are software engineers who are doing this at the professional level, were pretty good at those sorts of tasks when they were like 8. Most people who are writing at the professional level were really good at English class. We were the kids who turned in like a complete YA novel when we were in 5th grade. When everyone else was like writing in crayon and big letters to fill more space, we were the kids who were extra good at English class. And what did that do? You would think it would mean we could just go farther and faster. Instead, what it did was teach us this incredibly bad lesson, which is that success, that being good at something, is about finding work easy. The problem is, when you get to the pro league, and you guys are all there, right? Suddenly everyone's in that class. Every single person is at least as good as you were in high school and college. They were all the stars of their college paper. And you compare yourself to all of these amazing writers you've been idolizing, and suddenly, before you write it, you are like Oscar Wilde and Proust and George Orwell, just all rolled up into one delicious package. Everything is in your mind and it's perfect and it's clear, and then you start writing it. And the logical holes that you were kind of just bridging over when you were thinking about it, suddenly they open up and you were like teetering on this precipice of, oh my God, how am I possibly gonna fill that without falling in? All of a sudden your prose, which sounded great when you were just rehearsing, but the problem is you were only rehearsing like the 3 hilarious snippets that you had in your head. You weren't rehearsing the 9,700 words that had to go in between your 3 hilarious snippets. Suddenly it seems dull and ordinary, and suddenly you're frightened. And so as long as you haven't written it, it could still be good. But the moment that you start putting it down on paper, it is not as good as what you thought. And here is the really sad truth, is that, you know, like, everyone once in a while gets this piece, you think about it, it goes out on, like, just streams from your head straight to the paper, and it's perfect. It's sometimes even better than what was in your head. You're chuckling to yourself as you discover marvelous new things that you could write, but most of the time, it's not. It's not your best. It's not even like 85% of your best. Maybe 60%. So the easiest thing to do is to leave it undone, because as long as you haven't left it undone, you don't know that it's bad yet. You don't know that you didn't have what it takes to do this. And this is exactly the wrong way to think about writing, because then what you learn, if you kind of peek into the basement of other writers, is that they all did this. The problem is that when you're in English class, what are you reading? You're reading this poem. And as far as the teacher is concerned, it's perfect, right? And all you have to do is figure out exactly what the author meant. What was he saying here? You read all of the perfect poems that he wrote. You don't read the 97,000 drafts that he threw out because they weren't good. You don't read the days when Wordsworth kind of sounded more like a Hallmark card than like the poet laureate of Britain. You only read the reason we're so hard on ourselves, right, is that there's a great line from Pastor Stephen Furtick. He says, the reason we struggle so much with insecurity is that we compare our behind the scenes with everyone else's highlight reel. I remember going to a seminar with a bunch of English professors and me. Don't even ask how I ended up in the seminar. It was on Moby Dick. And we were discussing the last line. There's a whole chapter on whaling and how you figure out whether you're allowed to hunt a whale or not, whether someone else has like staked a claim to that whale. It's actually much more interesting than it sounds. Although, I guess if you're an economics policy journalist anyway, it's much more interesting than it sounds. But at the end of it, there's this great, completely oblique line, because what they're talking about is the difference between a fast fish, which someone else has and you can't touch, and a loose fish, which is fair game. It says, and what are you, dear reader, but a fast fish and a loose fish too? And there's 45 minutes of people discussing exactly what he might have meant. And I sort of raised my hand and I said, I'm just throwing this out here, but what if he just got to the end of the chapter and he needed to end it and he thought it sounded cool? You'd have thought I'd have been like, hey guys, after we're done with this seminar, what if we just went out and murdered some old ladies? And they were like, that's ridiculous. I can't believe it. This is Melville that you're talking. I was like, look, I'm just saying, I'm a professional writer. It happens. Like, the editor wants the manuscript. You've only got so long that you can play around with it before you have to turn it in. And the point is not whether maybe I'm wrong, and maybe he this was, you know, like the thing he was thinking about when he started to write Moby Dick, even before Call Me Ishmael. But the point is that that's how actual work and actual writing looks. It does not look like something springing full grown from the head of Zeus and leaping out onto the page beautifully. It looks like a work in progress. It looks like maybe sometimes you just kind of, okay, we're getting on there and move on. And that's true of all creative work, right? This is not just true of writing. I talk about writing because that, at this point, is what I know best. Although, if anyone would like a seminar on, like, you know, NT Server 4.0 afterwards, I'm, actually, probably you should get it from someone who, like, built the server. But I can tell you a lot of funny jokes about installing them on trading floors. So, what is it that we can do, right? So now we've decided we have this problem, which is that success is keeping us from. Well, how do you change that? So as it happens, there is a psychologist who talks a lot about this. She works mostly with children. And one of the experiments that she gave a series of tests to kids to see how they would respond to a challenge. It was really interesting because there was one group of people who would react to being challenged, to doing stuff that they don't know how to do, to failing, by getting really excited and turning into like a Tasmanian devil and going through it, and they would get better. And then there was another group who would hit a challenge they didn't like and they would stop. They'd be like, wow, this is really scary. I don't know what I'm doing. I should probably, I don't know, go mop floors or something. She's trying to figure out what the difference is between these two people. And she's looking at all her data and she's going over and over and over again. And one day she's talking to one of her graduate students. She has what she called a eureka moment. She said, suddenly I realized that the people who were changing were people who thought that doing a challenge you weren't necessarily very good at was a way to grow. That was how they were learning. And so they were willing to tackle these new things. And because that's how they thought of it, they in fact were learning. I mean, this is not just motivational speaker speak. It's actually true. How do you learn? You learn by doing stuff and not doing it very well. I'm sure lots of you in here, kids, right? How do they learn to walk, right?
Boom, boom,
right? And about the 80th time, they're like, oh, and then they fall again. But they get better and they stop falling so much. And fundamentally, success, we like to think that there's some grand plan, right? That there's a way to reason your way out of this. But then look at something like my favorite example of this, but you guys, I'm sure, can come up with a million, right? Like New Coke. I know a lot of you are young and may not remember New Coke, but for those of us who are perhaps on the wrong side of 40, in the early 1980s, Coke was really frightened because they had Pepsi crawling up on their rear, and Pepsi was doing these Pepsi challenge, take the Pepsi challenge, and everyone loved the Pepsi challenge, and Pepsi always won the Pepsi challenge, and so Coke decided they needed to take their 100-year-old formula and change it. So they go, the guy who's in charge of this project says, I want you to go and do the biggest market research study ever done. So they go out and they do the biggest market research. They all come back, oh my God, new formula. People love it, can't get enough. It's like sliced bread, but better in a jar. He says, okay, do it again. So they go out to another most expensive market research study ever done. Comes back, oh my God, it's amazing. You can't believe how much people love this product. It's gonna be the biggest thing since the space shuttle. Oops. Back, okay, one more time. So do all of these market research studies. And then they launch the product and it's a debacle. People hate it. Late night comedians are making this like their running joke every show. People are writing in to be like, I hate you, how could you do this to me? I wanna find your children and murder them. I mean, just endless people hated New Coke. Absolutely appalled. And the problem, what was the problem? Was it that they didn't work hard enough? They didn't plan enough? No. Problem was that you can't ask the question you really want to ask, right? A realistic model of the universe is the universe, right? Since we can't build that in a box and test it, we have to make simplifying assumptions. We have to use a model. And that model can just always inherently go wrong. So what did they do? They went to shopping centers and they gave people samples, blind taste tests. Here's the problem. First of all, New Coke and Pepsi are sweeter than Old Coke. People like sweet things in very small. So if you give people a drink, a sample of two drinks, the sweeter one just generally is going to win because it's sweeter. Second of all, you want to ask the question, right? When I put this on the shelves, are you guys going to buy a ton of it and go home and just guzzle it in front of the television? But it's not a question you can actually ask until you've done it. The only question you can ask is, if I give you a free sample of this in a shopping center, are you going to say you like this better than Pepsi? And they did. But that wasn't the question they really needed to know the answer to. So Coke did something really dumb, which was they bet the company on this, right? There was no reason you needed to launch New Coke and remove Old Coke. But they also did something really, really smart, which is they listened. And that sounds funny, but it's frightening how many people, there's basically three ways when something has gone wrong, when you've tried an experiment and it has failed. There's basically three things you can do, right? You can say, the information is incorrect, right? Something that our test isn't right, and in fact, New Coke is in fact the greatest thing since sliced bread, and we just need more of it. We should just double the production of New Coke because it's going to be so awesome. The second thing you can do is say, you know, my plan is fine, but there's something wrong with the universe. We just need, this is basically like the logic of the surge, right? Iraq's not going well, let's double it. And then maybe, and in fact, actually, so sometimes it works, right? Iraq actually did go, you can, not going well, but did better after the surge than it had been before that. The third thing you can do is say, my plan is not working, I should stop. And that's what Coke did. And when they pulled back and relaunched Old Coke, it actually turned out that they had reminded people what they had been forgetting, which was they loved Old Coke. And so it actually ended up being good for the company, but there was no way to tell that beforehand. We like to think that there is. But you think about, if that were true, the best tennis players in the world would be physicists, right? Because they would have an elaborate theory of why tennis balls do what they do. But that's not how tennis works. You learn to play tennis by hitting a tennis ball. And most of the time it doesn't go where it's supposed to, and then some of the time it does. And you learn that little feeling of what was I doing? You actually don't often know exactly what you're doing, but you know some of the things you weren't doing, and you kind of over time narrow down onto, oh, this works. We don't like that, right? We like to think that success is just a product of being really talented and of being smart. And so that is what the people, the other group of people that Dweck was looking at, they didn't think of being talented as something that you had to acquire through this incredibly painful and terrible process of trial and error. They thought of it as something you were just born with, right? They were the kids who were really good in school. And it's really true. I mean, teachers can tell fifth graders as much as they want that it's all about hard work, but like, you know who's doing their homework leaning up against a locker and who needs mom and dad to be there for 5 hours a night, right? I mean, it's fairly obvious. So it isn't that there's no differences in talent, but they're not actually, once you get beyond grammar school, the differences that matter the most. Unfortunately, these people had internalized that being smart was about finding work easy. And so they thought every time they hit a challenge, they thought of it as like a dipstick, right? You're just measuring how talented you are. And of course, what does that mean? Once you get beyond the easy challenges, it means that every time you're measuring, you might find you don't measure up. So what do? You avoid those challenges. You protect yourself. There's a phenomenon called self-handicapping, which is actually really interesting. They did an experiment. They gave people a test where it actually wasn't possible to get right answers. It was one of those sort of cryptic, puzzling answers, you know, triangles that don't really look like anything else, and then you're supposed to tell me which one of the group doesn't belong, and since there wasn't a right answer, then they would just tell people they'd scored really well. And those people didn't really know how they'd scored because they'd been totally mystified by this test, which was in fact objectively totally mystifying. So what did they do? They gave these people a choice between a drug that could inhibit their performance or one that could boost their performance. Some of the guys, especially guys, chose the performance-inhibiting drug. They deliberately chose to take something that would make them do worse. Why? Because then they'd have an excuse. Because then, you remember that kid in high school who got drunk the night before the SAT? Or the lots of kids in high school, some of which may have been named Megan McArdle, who didn't try on their work? Because as long as you haven't tried, you haven't really failed, right? As long as you haven't tried, well, it's not really a measure of you. You totally could have done it if you weren't so busy doing other, mastering the next level on Super Mario Brothers. We protect ourselves. But the problem is, of course, that we're also protecting ourselves from success. We're protecting ourselves from anything that comes outside of what we already know how to do, and that's pretty boring. And in the current economy, it's pretty dangerous, right? You're protecting yourselves from the kind of innovation that you need to do to stay competitive. Even in my field, you wouldn't think that like writing down words in a row. But in fact, my business is getting disrupted by you guys, frankly, and I'm not that happy about it. my business is getting the hell disrupted out of it. And you actually need to be innovating how you write, who you write for. I mean, the kind of writing that I do, I assume most of you are not regular readers of my blog, but the kind of writing that I do where I will do like 2,400 words on how the risk corridor, one little portion of Obamacare works, that's not a thing. That wasn't a thing until 10 years ago. It wasn't possible. First of all, you couldn't get the information. I want to know what the legal language is surrounding the statute. It's online. I can search it. I can find commentary on it instantly. The guys who were reporting on the budget 20 years ago, literally, they would go on Memorial Day weekend and they would camp out in front of the printing office. And you would get a seat close to the printing office. And then your value add was that you knew how to read the budget. Think tankers were so valuable merely because they had a copy of the budget, unlike the journalists who were calling them. What I do has been totally revolutionized in the past 20 years. And you know what? 2,500 words on the risk corridors in Obamacare, you couldn't write that for a normal paper, right? First of all, there wouldn't be the space. But second of all, in an audience of 10 million readers saying a pretty big size daily, of a million readers in a pretty big size daily, maybe 50,000 of them might want to read that, and the rest of them would be like, the technical term in journalism is MIGO, my eyes glaze over. But online, you can get a niche audience. But constantly, you have to be out there doing stuff that no one's ever done before. And that means that you have to be willing to tell yourself, OK, I'm going to try this thing. Probably isn't going to work. And I might look like a total idiot while I'm doing it. The good news is you actually can change this. So in the middle of interviewing Carol Dweck, I said, I feel like I can't let this go on any longer because I'm a total fixed mindset person. I read your book and now I feel guilty. And she was like, oh, me too. And I was so surprised. And she said, no, I really knew that I was changing when I heard myself saying, wow, I suck at this. This is really fun. But it took a long time. And so I'll finish off by saying, like, I've now been asked because I launched this book last Wednesday. So you guys are among the lucky early people who get to hear me talk about it and work out what I'm going to say in national audience. Is that you can change it. I've been asked if this is a self-help book. I don't know if it's a self-help book for anyone else. It's certainly not like the, five steps to make your relationship better. But for me, it actually was a self-help book because I'm a complete fixed mindset person. And I had this terror. It wasn't that I wouldn't do it necessarily, but I would procrastinate and things weren't as good as they could have been because I would put it off so long because I was so terrified of doing it wrong. And I have changed. I have heard myself saying, wow, I suck at this. This is really fun. So I'll close with that, is that we can change this. And it is actually sadly as simple as saying to yourself over and over and over again, I'm going to suck at this, giving yourself permission to suck. It's not that easy to do, but the rewards are fairly rich. And as a culture, and as organizations and companies, we have to do this. Because right now, entrepreneurship is down. People taking risks and our quit rates are down. People are not taking risks in our society. We need to get that back. That's where the economic growth that's going to come is going to come from that we desperately need. So I'll close there, open for Q&A. And are there any questions? I've blown you away with my incredible logic, or I was so boring that no one's.
Maybe this is outside the scope of your book, but what about the role of safety nets in people quitting or shooting off the
cliff? It is not outside the scope of my book. This was just chapter one. it's a great value. It only makes a great gift if you have any shaky table legs that need popping up. No, there's a huge role for safety nets. And so, but what you want to think about is how you're designing that safety net. So in order to make failure happen, you need to lower the cost of failure, right? Like, I was just talking about lowering the psychological cost of failure, but there's also the actual cost of failure in terms of I can't make my mortgage and so forth. But you need to do it smartly. So I have a chapter on employment, which is, I think, the greatest crisis facing America right now, the greatest crisis facing most modern economies right now, and one where you really see this the most starkly. So Europe's approach to this is that unemployment feels terrible, which it does. It is the worst thing that can happen to you in a modern democracy, short of death or dismemberment. And so let's make it hurt less. So they have they have generous unemployment benefits that last a really long time and replace a really high portion of your salary. And what you see then is that they also have extremely high unemployment rates. And so what do they do when that happens? They say, oh, well, we'd better make it harder for workers for companies to fire people because we're getting all this unemployment. And that doesn't improve your unemployment rate. In fact, what it means is that no one wants to hire young workers. And so you've seen this bifurcation in a lot of European economies and elsewhere, where everyone over the age of 50 has it great, and then everyone under the age of 30 basically can't get a permanent full-time job. And that's enormous lost human capital. So how do you think about failure? Should hurt, right? It should feel bad because the reason we don't keep doing whatever it was we were doing that didn't work is that it feels bad. But it should feel bad in a kind of specific way, which is that it should feel bad, but it should not be crippling. What they've done is make it feel too good to be unemployed. And it still doesn't feel good. People still report being completely miserable. If you're divorced, if you lose your spouse, if you're widowed, so forth, after about 5 years, your happiness level is about back where it was. Actually, widows, funnily enough, like a little higher. but people who are unemployed are basically almost as sad as they were the day they lost their job. So it's not, and that's in Germany. It's not like in America, wherever they're all like bankrupt or whatever. So how do you think about a good safety net that doesn't encourage to make people what is a rational short-term decision? Because job search is really terrible. It's basically saying, hey, want to reject me? And everyone's like, yes! So how do you help people to help themselves while not falling into the pit? The thing where America does this really well is actually bankruptcy. And we don't usually think of that as a safety net. It's actually a really good safety net program. If you get yourself in trouble with debt, as many Americans are prone to do, because we have the deepest and richest and most widely available credit markets in the world, we say, you know what, you can walk in and be like, can't pay. And the judge is like, okay, your debts are gone. And you take a hit on your credit report, and then you leave. And Europeans can't believe this. Nowhere else in the world is this true. Literally, I reported on this for The Economist, and like I took some doing to convince my colleagues that I was not having them on. For this book, I was interviewing an expert. There's a guy, expert on Russia, completely unrelated, just randomly in the middle of the interview, starts making fun of the American bankruptcy system for being too lax. But actually, it's great. Because if you look, America has a really neat little natural experiment. Our bankruptcy law is federal, but the exemptions are determined at the state level. So you can actually look and see what happens when one law with different generosity levels. And it ranges from like you can exempt $3,000 of home equity to like buy a $5 million McMansion and it's totally shielded from creditors. And it turns out that the more generous exemptions you have, the more entrepreneurship you get. For two reasons. So one reason, because people look at this prospectively and they say, oh, well, at least I won't lose the house and the kids will have somewhere to sleep. But it's also because if you don't let people move on, you've taken someone who had the daring and the gumption to start a business, who presumably learned quite a lot about this. And this is the thing that's great about America's tech industry, right? It's like, oh yeah, your business failed. Great, we want to hire you, right? That's not a thing that happens in Europe. I mean, it does occasionally, but like Europeans in general are like, what's wrong with you? Why would you go do something crazy? And then clearly you couldn't even make it work. Why would I want you working for me? You take someone who knows a lot of valuable information and you shackle them to their old debts. And one of the people I interview in the book is a Danish entrepreneur. He's been struggling with the debt from a business that he started in the 80s and that went sour in 2001, still trying to pay off that debt. It's still basically as big as it was the day that he had to lay off 6 employees. And laying off 6 employees in Denmark was a catastrophic event for him that he's still struggling with today because the amount of payments he had to make were so large to cover their severance. So it's actually a good welfare. We want to think of more systems like that. So what do you do now when unemployment is elevated? Our answer was to be more European, but it does look like evidence from North Carolina, where they just cut off extended unemployment benefits, and now some other macro studies are showing that it does look like we increased unemployment that way. Again, because when you look at surveys of job searchers about their day, they report the worst thing they do is look for a job. And so what happens is you lose a job, and you're really intense looking for a job for a couple weeks, and then every time you're looking for a job, you get anxious and worried and rejected, and it feels terrible, and so you stop. And so you just have no choice. And unfortunately, because their resumes are aging, and this is disastrous in the current economy, we helped people to make a bad decision. How might we have helped them to make a good decision? Well, one way is the way Denmark does, where they say, look, we're going to replace a lot of your income. It's called flexicurity. But you have to retrain. You can't sit around and say, I want to be a steel worker, and I'm just going to wait until they reopen steel working in my small area. Another way we might have done it is to hire them directly. We could have said to the government, look, instead of unemployment benefits, we're going to give you a job. It's not going to be a great job. It's just going to be something you show up, you work 40 hours a week, we'll pay you some basic income check. Doesn't compete with a private sector job, but hey, we get something for our money. And also, they get somewhere to go and leave the house, because depression is a huge point, a huge problem with people who are unemployed. And also skills loss, and really basic loss, like reading and math, like basic arithmetic, not physics. Something about being unemployed really hurts human capital. Or we could have done something like what I've been pushing recently. We could have said to employers, hire someone who's been long-term unemployed. For every month that they've been unemployed, we give you a month off their payroll tax on both sides, worker and employer. It's basically a 15% wage subsidy for hiring the unemployed. We could have tried harder to keep people connected to the labor force, and instead we did the opposite. And that's how you always have to be thinking about these policies. Are we helping someone fail well? Are we helping them fail badly? Disability is a really bad program, not for people who, you know, have lost legs and so forth, but for people who have back pain and low skills. It's a really bad program. It takes them out of the labor force permanently and puts them on really, really not very high incomes. So that's how I would like to see us approach our safety net. Yes, a safety net is vital. Letting people know that they can recover from a failure is vital to keeping, both on a personal level of American citizens we don't want to be, you know, stuck and impoverished and destitute, but also on an economy-wide level. But it has to be done right. It has to be always thinking about, are we encouraging someone to move on, or are we encouraging them to get stuck? Sorry, it was a really long, yes?
Yeah, you wrote something a while ago, you are a terrible investor and you should stop that. And I was struck by that title. But how would you think about reconciling that, which, you know, you could argue holds, hey, don't try to go get alpha, you're not gonna go get it, with the idea of proactively, you know, seek high risk, high failure, high reward scenarios?
Well, I'll start with, I think there's alpha in some markets. So, a friend of mine invests in microcaps, tiny, tiny little, right? There's alpha there because they're not liquid and you have to do quite a lot of legwork. There is not alpha in the broader stock market. There's too many people looking for that. Part of it is that, stocks are actually, in a way, a good example. It's a random walk, right? You can't predict tomorrow's stock price from today's stock price. The best guess is actually today's stock price. It's going to move in some random fashion around that. And I do think of myself that way. You know, when I was looking for a job, I was not very planned about it. You know, I was doing freelance journalism. I also had a small business technology consulting business on the side, and I was doing some other small business consulting. And I had, you know, backup plans H, I, and J if those things didn't work out. Is that fundamentally, I do actually believe in serendipity. And so when people come to me and say, I'm unemployed, what do I do? And a lot of people write into journalists who write about unemployment right now. I say, leave the house. I'm less focused on, like, because I can't tell you what, you know, I don't know you that well, et cetera. What I can tell you is that whatever is going to happen is not going to happen in your bedroom. So go get a job at Walmart, go volunteer, go do something, start a blog, have a hobby. I don't care what it is. Leave your house, be doing something that is not passive. As long as you are doing something active, there is an opening for something to happen. And I think that that's generally true. Like, how many entrepreneurs have I talked to? I'm sure you guys have talked to a lot of them, right? Who say, yeah, we thought we were going to do this one thing. And then 6 months later, it turned out that we actually had a business raising, you know, artisanal organic chicken. Who knew? Seemed like laser pointers were good, but chicken was actually where we ended up. And there's a surprising number of those things as people who discover that what they thought they were going to do didn't work. So one of the guys I talk about in the book, Jim Manzi, owner of Applied Predictive Technologies, who thought out starting that they were going to build these giant massive servers and put them on the client so the client could run tests. Then it turned out they had a little web test module. And they were just at the client kind of demoing it and testing things. Right, they would go into the server from the client site just to sort of look at stuff and so forth. And the client was like, so why can't we use that web interface? And they're like, no, we do giant servers on site. And finally, after they were really kind of running out of money and the client kept saying, no, we would really like the web interface part, he realized that what he was going to be doing was software as a service. But he did not start off thinking that at all. And now that's a fairly minor adjustment, but there have also been some really major adjustments of people who were in completely different businesses than they thought they were getting into. Ray Kroc, right, was selling milkshakes, and then the next thing you know, he's franchising McDonald's. And it's kind of related, but not really where he thought his life was going. So I think that planning is important, but it's limited. And ultimately, the universe is going to come in and be like, yeah, yeah, this life is what happens when you're making other plans. So I don't think that you should ever count on your brilliant brilliance to generate alpha anywhere, right? It's great if it happens, but always hedge, right? And this is like, if you read me, you know, I always tell people, do not, there's basically two life strategies, right? Put all your eggs in one basket and watch that basket, or hedge. Always hedge. Always have at least one exit strategy.
So is there a point that, you know, after you try, you fail so many times, you know, you just figure out, yeah, I might not be very good at this, just go back and do something safe. Is there a point that, you know, you would just say, no, that's not?
Well, I mean, I think safe is a relative term. There's a bunch of questions about it in there. I'll try to answer all of them. I think safe is a relative term. In some ways, there's nothing as dangerous as safe. Right? When was I in my most dangerous point? When I thought that a Chicago MBA was a guarantee of a good job and I didn't really have to do much except show up. And similarly, like, when was the US economy at its most vulnerable? When everyone thought they'd found a guaranteed way to make money by buying houses. So, you know, when you think that you have found something that can't go wrong, is when you are most likely to, say, get yourself in a job, not invest in new skills, not maintain contacts outside, and then have that company fail and have you be stranded. And that's a story we're hearing a lot right now, right? That said, other half of that question, when do you quit? Good question. I have several chapters on this because it's really important, right? The essence of failing is not just if at first you don't succeed, try again, because doing the same thing and expecting a different result is crazy. So how do you know when it's time? The first answer is that you go in assuming that failure is on the table, right? And that means by starting, do not bet the house on anything, but then you go in saying, you know, we know that there's a high probability this might not work out. And we have benchmarks for that. And you don't necessarily have to be like, well, if it hasn't worked in 3 months, we shut it down, right? But you have to say, if it isn't working after 6 months, okay, do I know why it's not working? Because if I know why it's not working, then maybe I can say I can fix it. But if it's, I know why it's not working, and this doesn't seem to have a revenue model. And we can't seem to find one, and probably that's going to be the end. I was talking to an entrepreneur the other night who said, you know, it's a great project. Revenue is difficult, right? Audience is easy, revenue is difficult. The main thing is, first of all, to be watching for it. And the second thing is not to do what orienteers call bending the map, where you have a plan and you're checking your benchmarks and you're not where you wanted to be. And so you start saying, you know, maybe this rock is that rock there that doesn't really look much like this rock on the map, but I don't know, it could be, right? You start telling yourself that even though you kind of suspect you're lost, that no, you start convincing yourself you're not. And that is the most dangerous place to be in, right? Because now you're going to get yourself more lost. Because you don't know where you are and you're going somewhere else where you really have no idea, right? The safe thing to do when you get lost is to stop and backtrack. It's difficult, and you need an internal constituency for that. So the thing I like to think about is a person on the team that I call Dr. No. Everyone's had, I was this person. Everyone hated me. I'd be like, this is not going to work. Let me enumerate the 97 ways that your plan is not going to work. And it's really, that person is so irritating. And I know that when I am not being Dr. No and it's someone else who's raining on my parade, I'm really irritated. But that person's super valuable because that person is going to tell you, you don't have to let them stop what you do, but they're going to tell you all of the ways that this could go disastrously awry. You're going to have a long list of all the holes you need to plug. And then you need auditor. You need a person. Not just, or you designate yourself that role. Someone has to be designated the role of really saying, is this working? What's not working? How is this not performing the way we expected? And we don't like to do that, right? We're all excited. We're all getting to yes. And it's hard to be like, I'm the person who's in charge of putting the brakes on this. And often it's the CFO, right? Like, he's the guy who's like, we don't seem to have any revenue. But you need that. You need those constant checks. And then if it's not working, you have to be willing to cut your losses. Do not double down, right? Do not say, the universe is fine. My plan is fine. The universe seems to have a problem. Let's just do twice as much and hope that that works, even though that's the most common reaction.
Yeah, from your experience of stories that you said, there probably would have been some moments where when you're trying and failing, it would have been easy to say quits. And so what made you go that extra mile that you found, the traction again to move forward?
Well, for one thing, my parents really wanted me out of their spare bedroom. and I'm actually not kidding about that. Families are like the best form of safety net when they're working right. Because on the one hand, they really love you and they don't want you to feel bad. But on the other hand, they're going to, like, if you're not doing enough, they're going to kick your butt to get out of the spare bedroom. And they can kind of titrate that as needed. When my husband, literally 2 weeks after we moved in together, my husband lost his job. And he wasn't my husband then, he was my boyfriend. I guess I'm now telling all of Microsoft, but that I lived in sin. But So 2 weeks after we moved in together, we were friends for a while. We actually hadn't been dating for that long, and he lost his job. And I was like, okay, well, we're going to make a drop dead plan. We're going to figure out, like, this is when this month we break the lease, et cetera. And then I encouraged him to go play video games. Video games are really, by the way, if you're ever in the emergency room or something, video games, take your iPad and or your Android or your Microsoft tablet and I'm actually looking at one of your cool Microsoft touchscreen thingies. I forget the name of the company. I'm sorry. I was just looking at it the other day and considering buying one. But take your tablet or your phone and play games. Because video games are great. They occupy exactly the part of your brain that otherwise would be freaking out. And so they're actually a really good way to short-circuit anxiety. And they actually use them now. They're doing studies on using them in pediatric emergency rooms and so forth because they're great at this. They're really good at short-circuiting anxiety because it occupies the part of your brain that otherwise would be like, so when we're homeless. But here's the thing. And like he tells that story, and he said that that was when he knew he was going to marry me. But I could also watch. We both do the same thing. He's also a policy journalist. And so I knew who he should be talking to. I knew what he should be doing. I could see him freelancing. I could see his pieces running. And I, like, had he not been working double time to get a job, we would have had a very different conversation about his. But as it was, he had an Xbox. He played a lot of video games. And now he, like, reviews video games and plays Xbox all the time, so I created a monster. But the point is that in a family, you can do that. It's harder to do, like, as a government. The main thing I think was that I am a bit like a Tasmanian devil. Like when things go wrong, I just kind of go into freak out mode, and that has its downsides. But the upside is that I will just do a lot of stuff. Much of it doesn't work, but some of it does. And the people that I knew, as I watched obviously in 2001, right? I was in tech. I think the nadir of my life in tech, and this does have a point, my storytelling is somewhat discursive, but was walking into a recruiter who in 1999 had been calling me like every 3 weeks and being like, please leave, I'll double your salary, right? And then I walked in 2000. I was so desperate to get a job. I was trying to go back to doing what I did, which, you know, installing networks in 2001 was also not a hot field. And this giant office, there's all these desks and only three of them in one corner are occupied. And the guy was like, I don't have a job for you. I don't have a job for my brother-in-law. I'm not even gonna have a job for me pretty soon. So you should go find a banker and get married. I was like, but they've been laid off too. The people I saw who recovered, some people just, you know, they got laid off and they just found another job doing it, and like really quickly. But the people who kind of got down in the pit with me, there were a lot of us. There were basically two kinds of people. There were people who were like, I need a plan and I'm gonna have this really elaborate plan and I need to figure out what I'm gonna do with the rest of my life. And those people didn't get up because they were too busy trying to find the perfect thing. And the people who moved on were the people who just kept moving. They were just like, and in the book I talk about this, about unemployment, you can think of it as sort of like a dark room. You don't know where the exit is. So the only thing you can do is just keep circulating. The people who sit down because it's dark and scary just get stuck. And that's ultimately it, is I have many flaws as a person, but like when something goes wrong, I go Tasmanian devil and eventually find a way out.
So you said something earlier about finding this career that's something that you love and that you're really good at. So I feel like oftentimes you have this trade-off between seeking out opportunities for growth in areas that are already your strength, as opposed to chipping it away, like growing in areas that are current weaknesses and like chipping away at those. So I'm wondering if you have a thought on like certain scenarios in which one makes more sense than the other, or like does one typically yield a greater return, or sort of like that seems like a big trade-off, and I'm curious to hear your thoughts.
It is a trade-off. And you do have to think about it strategically, and there's never gonna be just like one perfect answer. But there are some things that I'm just not good at, right? Like I played basketball in high school, and aside from being tall, there's nothing about basketball that I'm good at. I'm very good at being tall. I'm slow, I can't jump, et cetera. Like that is not an area, it's great if you play basketball recreationally, but that's not an area where like I ever should have invested a great deal of my effort, because there was never any shot that I was gonna be good at that. And you see people like that, like I had a friend who's like, you know, I really need to grow my management and so forth. And he's like an amazing engineer, and he hates being around people. It's like, why do you want to move into management? You love what you do now. You don't like sitting in meetings all day. The job description that he was like, but you know, that's growth. Like growth comes in many areas. You should actually identify things that are just deal breakers for you, either because you hate them. I mean, if you genuinely just hate something and it's not just like, I have to suck this up as part of, you know, like everyone has parts of their job that they don't like. But if it's genuinely like, when I think of doing this thing all day, it fills me with dread, no matter how much of a growth opportunity it is, you should not spend too much time trying to grow that skill. At the same time, you know, like I hate talking on the phone. I've never gotten on a phone call without developing an exit strategy immediately. And this is a weird thing about bloggers. We all hate talking on the phone. There's like a few exceptions, but every blogger I know goes to enormous lengths to avoid talking on the phone, like not activating their voicemail so that it's not actually possible to contact them that way. But you know what? I got to get on the phone. And that's something that like you actually can get better at. I got better at making myself make phone calls and make lots of phone calls and sit on the phone with people and keep asking them questions and so forth. Those are things where you say, you know what, I don't like this, but I really like that part, and that's the way through. And then you sort of strategically grow that. But if the destination is somewhere where you don't really want to be, then it doesn't make sense to, no matter how sort of standard that may seem, find a way that does not involve getting to a destination you don't want to be at.
How do you think this fits in with like schools and grades? Because I feel like maybe a lot of kids decide to take classes that are easier maybe because they're scared of grades. holding them back from higher education and opportunities later on down the road?
Chapter one. No, this is seriously the... I'm developing into, despite the fact that I'm obviously a product of it, I'm developing into a seriously deep critic of the whole obsessive credentialism. I mean, it's created two bad things. So on the one hand, the fact that there's now this funnel that seems to basically only run through higher education at a selective college, right? So for poor kids, they're like, it's not that they can't do it, but it's like they're like Nadia Comaneci, right? They've got to hit a perfect 10. If they got any points knocked off, they're just not going to make it through that next challenge. On the other hand, what does this do to upper middle class parents? And I watch my friends doing this now. It's particularly bad in New York, which is where in New York City where I grew up. But it's getting bad everywhere. It's the same now in Washington. I know it's the same. I know it's the same in San Francisco. I can only presume that it is getting to be the same here, where a trader I know took his 3-year-old daughter into an interview for a very exclusive preschool. And you've really got to get into a good preschool, because if you don't, getting into a good kindergarten's hard. And then if you're not in a good kindergarten, entrance to an excellent grade school program is really going to hamper your ability to get into a good high school. And obviously, if you don't get into a good high school, it's basically over. So they said, what are her aspirations? And he was like, we're trying to get her to stop eating gum off the street. Like, what? He's from Long Island. Like, this is not a thing. But this that system, right? And it's happening in public schools too. It's particularly absurd in New York and Washington, but it is. It's turning into the same thing everywhere, which is that the sense that we can't let them fail at all, right? Because if we have to hover all the time, because if they get knocked off, if they get bad grades or they don't, then we had better. So we better make sure that they're taking classes they can get an A in. And we better be there making sure that they don't do anything, like get suspended, nothing that's going to go on their record. When I was a senior, one of my teachers who had taken a dislike to me, and I'm sure I was eminently dislikable as a teenager, but she tried to sort of unfairly lower my grade. I'm not going to go into the really tedious details, but just take it as written, because I eventually won the dispute that she was in the wrong. And my parents were like, well... This is first semester of senior year, so last grade's college. And they're like, gosh, that's too bad. You know, one of the things you really need to learn is how to get along with authority, so you'd better figure this out. And like, that's unthinkable now, that a parent would do that, because the stakes are too high. And so instead, do y'all follow the Harvard cheating scandal? I know we all seem like we're very far off on the East Coast, like with our crazy little Ivy Leagues and, Snow. But so you had 125, however many it was, kids who professed to be unable to understand that they, when they were given a test that was where the instructions were somewhat confusing, that said at the bottom, do not discuss this with anyone else, that meant they weren't supposed to email each other about it. Right? But they had been so sheltered their whole life. The number of people in my Twitter feed under the age of 25 who seemed to think that those kids had the right of it was shocking to me. And so this whole system seems to me to be a complete disaster. It's breeding kids who, and you know, I was really skeptical of all the trophy kid stuff because geezers have been complaining about the kids these days forever. And in fact, I think millennials work harder than my generation certainly did, and they're way more focused. We were just total screw-ups. Generation X, God love us. But they're raised in this environment where there's always someone telling them exactly what to do and exactly what the next step. And I've talked to managers who have hired multiple generations and who aren't saying this because like they're like, no, millennials, terrible. But Generation X, awful, hated you. But it's this very specific thing of needing a phenomenal amount of structure and needing to be told exactly what the next step is. And that is not the way the real world works. And I think it's setting everyone up for just very, very bad, things, all the way from the elites down. So anyway, sorry, that was my extended rant, but like this is half of chapter one, because I really do feel strongly that this intense focus on pushing kids through this very one, very narrow gap is immensely destructive and not how we used to be. American education has always been very good at helping people reenter and giving people opportunities. I mean, you guys know better than anyone, right? College dropout, founded your company. it's getting harder.
So how do you fix that?
That is the $10,000 question. Part of it is that we stop acting like, I mean, like, they're now requiring college degrees for bartenders. I mean, like, I majored in drinking too, but Jesus. like, it's feeding on itself. And people really have to stop, instead of filtering 90 zillion resumes through Monster for exactly the five things that you've set up, like, remember that humans are multitudinous and different, and that five credentials that you can hit on a resume search. I mean, like, technology is actually making things worse, but I think we could make a decision. And I actually think that companies that do decide to go in a different direction are going to have some alpha. They're going to have some, like, a competitive advantage because they're going to be picking up the people who are undervalued. But I don't think it's happened yet.
You were head of an HR department in, let's say, Microsoft. You were looking at resumes of candidates, right? Marketing jobs, engineering jobs. What are the things you would look for to find, you know, good people?
I wouldn't look for college degrees. I wouldn't look for elite degrees. Honestly, and like, look, I went to an Ivy League school. I went to a top five business school. It's not that I think the people who did these things are somehow unworthy of, I just don't think it should be much of a plus or a minus, because the fact is that, like, my husband graduated from the University of North Florida, and he's an amazing writer, and thank God I have him as my editor, because without him, I would be seriously hosed. And, you know, like, one of the smartest guys I know graduated from, I think, Northern Iowa. I always say Eastern Iowa, and I don't think there is an Eastern Iowa. I mean, I think there is an Eastern part of Iowa, but there's not a university there. And he said in Washington, this is just rampant, and he said he could always tell people he wasn't going to like, because they'd be like, where'd you go to school? And he would say, oh, you know, Northern Iowa. And they would just, like, their eyes would glaze over, and they would just start looking around the room for someone else to talk to, because God knows, someone who went to a state college couldn't possibly have anything interesting to say to us. Right? I mean, this is absurd. This is just completely ridiculous. So I would just put a lot less, you know, yes, educational credentials for people who are, like, engineers and need to make bridges stand up and so forth. But for most of us, like, the best, when I was in tech, right, the best guy I knew had been a religious studies major at Swarthmore. And he said the best guy he knew had operated a camera store for a while, was Orthodox. And he said one night, I don't remember what the problem that they were trying to solve, but I did love the description of this guy sitting there, and, like, the seconds are ticking down to sunset on a Friday. And this guy is just like, okay, I'm just gonna have to rewrite this on the fly in assembler. So he's, like, writing machine code to fix the problem, and, like, finishes with, like, 3 seconds before sunset. And he's like, gotta go, and runs down the stairs. And had, like, as far, I'm not even sure I had gone to college. Like, everyone in tech, when I was doing IT, everyone had those guys. One of our great guys working on like the routers and the networking equipment had been a porter at one of the offices that my consulting company served. And then he started running cable for us. And then the next thing you know, I mean, like, we all had those people, but even in tech, right? It's increasingly, no, you want to see the 40. So I would take that stuff off, because I don't think that tech has changed so much that suddenly those people aren't valuable and amazing workers anymore. The things I would look for actually is the people who've tried something completely different and discovered that this is what they want to do. Because first of all, those people are passionate, right? They're here because they actually really care. And you can say, oh, well, they're dilettantes and so forth. But careers are long now, right? It's not like we all die at 40. The people who have kind of wandered into this and then stuck with it for 10 years are the people who really care about this. They're the people who really want to be here, not the people who just kind of started doing this when they were in college and never stopped. So I would look for more failure. I would look for more non-traditional. I would look for more people with imagination, and the people who hit a wall somewhere else and, like, turned around and ended up here, those are people who are actually, when you hit a wall, going to be the people you want to have in the room. But, you know, on the other hand, maybe there's reasons people don't make me their HR director, so. Any other questions? Okay, well, thank you very much.